Thank you for having me tonight. Gabby and reached out earlier in the fall and asked if I'd be interested in coming back. And I always jump at the chance to come and share with the PTSA groups information that you find helpful or interested in. 2 years ago, we were together for a presentation on updates on youth concussions, and I recognize quite a few of you that were here for that presentation. Thank you for coming back. I'd like to thank the principals from our elementary and high schools for being here tonight, and I think they're still here or might have slipped out, but Ty, thanks for being here. Only because there's not a Dallas game on tonight, right? No. Anyway, I'm excited to be here with you tonight because there's a lot of new information that I think you'll find interesting, and some updates about the research that's ongoing right now, and also implications for our sports programming going forward, specifically youth sports programming. So. As I go through, if you have a question, don't hesitate to ask. I will have a question and answer segment at the end, and I promise I will get done in an hour, and if we don't, Gabby's gonna pull me off, but I'll stick around if you have any questions or wanna talk. Is this volume okay with everyone? Okay. Okay, good. I promise this is not gonna be an anatomy lesson, but We've seen such a change in attitudes on sports concussions since the time I was with you last. We went from the old school premise of you just got your bell rung, just shake it off, you'll be fine, go back into the game, and then we got to that period of time where we were really learning a lot from the research that it wasn't just simply a matter of giving a kid a few minutes to clear their head on the sideline before sending them back in the game. We began to learn a little bit about the brain anatomy and the significance of head trauma. And then we kind of cycled in, and a lot of this was kind of the result of all the attention that it received in the media. We are kind of, I wouldn't say in the midst, but hopefully coming out of the middle of a cycle where there's some skepticism on the number of concussions that are being reported or that we're saying exist in particularly in youth sports. A lot of feedback I hear sometimes from coaches and even parents, well, if a kid has a headache, you say he has a concussion. So we kind of went from here to here, and now we're coming back down a little bit. So I thought the best thing to do tonight, and what I value, is you passing this information along. For those that couldn't be with us tonight, I think it's important to understand what it is about the youth brain that makes a concussion in this age group so significant. Because if you don't understand that piece of it, you're not going to understand why we are so concerned about this and why we're talking about kids maybe shouldn't play contact sports before a certain age. So if you'll bear with me and let me do a little bit of anatomy about the brain before we get into this, I think you'll really appreciate having this information so that once we get to the research that we're doing, it makes sense why we're looking at that kind of research. Oops. So if you notice, you may not realize that by age six, the adolescent brain is about 90% of the size it's going to be. But the important part to realize is that it continues to develop almost to the age of 18. So as that brain tissue is developing, nerve tracts are maturing, blood vessels are maturing, synapses, everything about the brain that makes it work is growing. And any type of injury that occurs during that growth phase is going to be significantly more impactful than if it were to happen to an organ or a body part that's already fully matured. And just to give you a little visual, this is a time-lapsed MRI image of an adolescent brain age 5 all the way up to 20 years. Now, if you'll notice, in the younger ages, you'll see a lot of gray matter, and that's indicated by the orange, or the red, the yellow, and the green, because at that younger age, that's when the gray matter, white matter is really developing, but then you'll see as they get toward the age of 20, where the brain is mature, you see how it diminishes? So we quickly start to lose gray matter viability during the adolescent period. And if you damage that tissue during that growth phase, then that's why we end up with such potential for health concerns about the brain or functioning into the 20s, 30s, 40s, and on into elderly ages. What you need to understand is how the brain transfers information within that body, that organ. The brain communicates through axons, but that axons, and I'm going to show you a picture in just a second, it might be the next one. But anyway, the synapses are kind of the intersections where chemicals are released that allows signals on the nerve paths to jump from one axon to another. That's how information is passed through in the brain. There's a rapid number of synapses developing during this adolescent growth period, and quickly, though, after you get to about age 8 or 10, the synapses have developed, and now it's kind of like pruning a tree. Or if you're a gardener, you know, it spurs growth by pruning away old and letting it branch out. That's what's happening with the brain up until about age of 18. And during this time, gray matter, which is associated with your ability to think and process information, it decreases during adolescence, and this happens earlier with females. So you may hear in some of the research studies they're looking at, are concussions more of a concern for female adolescents versus male adolescents? This is why, because they're losing gray matter as they go through that growth period quicker than boys are. White matter, when you think of white matter, think of subway system, okay? The white matter is the tissue of the brain that transfers information. Okay. If that transfer is not happening, the brain, the gray matter can be functioning, but the information isn't getting connected, isn't getting relayed to the areas of the brain where it needs to go in order to make things happen. You'll see that white matter increases as gray matter is decreasing. So you have two paths that are just going in opposite directions. And because of that, any type of damage from a head injury during this time can significantly affect the integrity of that material. It can keep it from reaching the full growth cycle, and it can also reduce the amount of that type of tissue that develops. And here's a MRI image, and on the left, you'll see the gray and white matter. And on the right, that image is a diffuser tension image. The photo on the right is a diffuser tensor image, and that's where the imaging tracks water movement through the white matter. Okay, so think of the white matter as little mini highways, subway system, and then the gray and white matter, okay? The other thing that is very susceptible to long-term damage during this growth period are the blood vessels that supply blood and nutrients to the brain tissue, and also glucose metabolism. If blood flow through the developing brain is interrupted due to injury, glucose metabolism is going to be affected adversely. So if glucose isn't reaching the brain tissue, you're getting cell death that can't be reversed. Concussive injuries impact both of those processes. Affects the blood vessels first. You get blood vessels that might be ruptured or partially torn or twisted. Can't deliver glucose. Brain doesn't receive the nutrients that it needs to keep that gray and white matter functioning. So understanding the relationship between that anatomy and concussions in the developing brain that's hopefully is guiding our research studies right now. And I know Christine, she's been very, very proactive in staying involved and up to date on all the research studies going on. And we'll be talking about those in just a little bit near the latter part of the presentation. I think you'll find those very interesting. Most people mistakenly think that the impact, that initial impact, is what determines how severe the head injury is going to be. And if you were here with us when we did our very first concussion presentation, had a couple images that showed that not quite to be the case. Certainly, the force of the impact is what starts the injury in motion, but you could have a hellacious head-to-head contact or contact with the ground. That doesn't really, that's not really what's caused the damage. What causes the damage is once that brain starts moving inside the skull because of the impact, it doesn't just move in a linear motion. It doesn't just move on a straight line forward and back. And that's the misconception that a lot of people have. It just goes straight back, straight forward. What happens are all those small axons, let me see. That next picture. These are the axons we were talking about that pass information in the brain. As the brain starts moving inside the skull as a result of impact, these axons get twisted. And if they get twisted so severely that they're unable to unwind, so to speak, then it eventually causes the death of those axons. So you no longer have the ability for the brain to communicate within itself. So what researchers are studying now, instead of the damage that occurs because of the severity of the hit, what they're now doing are developing sensors that measure the way the brain is moving inside the skull. Is it moving straight back? Is there a rotation involved? Is there both? Is it rotating as it's moving back and forth? And they're finding that more often than not, the impact is causing the brain to twist as it moves back and forth in the skull. An adult brain, not such a big deal because our blood vessels, our nerve pathways, they're more established, they're sturdier. In the adolescent brain, huge deal because they're so fragile at that point in time. And even a mild concussion, and if you talk to the experts, they say if anyone ever tells you, this child has a mild concussion, that immediately sends a red flag up for you because there is no such thing as a mild concussion in an adolescent. Any concussion is significant in a brain that's developing. So the types of head movement that we're talking about are the linear, the rotational, and the syndroidal motion that they're studying. That type of motion is when you get directly, the force is driven directly from the top straight down through the center of the brain. Okay. And that tends to have more of an effect on the white matter of the brain because the white matter is the interior of the brain. So force driving straight down from top to bottom will tend to impact the white matter. And the injury threshold, that twisting, the inability for it to untwist, is significantly lower in adolescents than it is in adults. And this is just a schematic of what actually is happening once you have an impact to the brain and you get that translation, whether it's linear or rotational or both. A metabolic cascade is set off. You have chemicals released that cause swelling to occur, that can cause blood flow to diminish, that can cause the potassium sodium to be in places that it should not be and cause the inability for it to get back where it should go, the permeability of the sheaths that line the nerve paths. So, and quickly moving through this anatomy part, the adolescent's brain's ability to auto-regulate blood flow and glucose is much lower than an adult's brain. So if you have any disturbance to that mechanism, it's going to be more profound in the adolescent brain. And that's what typically we try to measure when we do the clinical evaluations. At Children's National, University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, they look at those markers for potassium levels, sodium levels, calcium levels in the brain following a head injury to try to see how much disturbance was caused. The other thing that research is bearing out right now is the damage that's occurring for the production of free radicals. If you remember years ago, you heard the mention of free radicals in the context of cancer, free radicals being released and doing damage to good cells. They're now finding quite a few studies are finding that the elevation in free radicals in the adolescent brain is quite significant to compared to head trauma in adults. So if you have a higher level of free radicals being released because of the result of a head injury, it's going to be more profound in the youth brain. Sure.
So if the biomarker, if somebody had a child had a concussion 15 years ago at the age of 12, mm-hmm. and right now they have still do biomarkers today to see whether this is a calcium.
Some of the research studies ongoing right now, they're looking to see if there's any permanent, for instance, if you have a lower potassium or calcium level as a result of that injury and it doesn't resolve, that count still going to be lower 1 year later, 6 months later, 2 years later? That's what they're looking at right now.
Could a head scan show these axons?
Depending on the scan, it depends on the scan that's done, and later on in the presentation I'm going to go through all the scans that are available for head injury imaging, okay, and you'll understand, it'll help you understand what scans can show you what information.
And is it typically that they're doing symptoms?
Yes, and I'm going to come back to that point in just a second. The pituitary gland in the adolescent brain is also significantly affected, and this is where you're looking as the cause for all the emotional disturbances or symptoms that you see post-concussion. A lot of the symptoms, you think of headaches, dizziness, memory issues, but unless you've lived through this, if you've had a child that's had a concussion, you might not be aware that you will have extreme swings of behavior, moods, depression, irritability, anger. You can be talking to a child 1 minute and they're fine, the next minute they're crying, or the next minute they're having a temper tantrum. It's because of the pituitary gland's inability to regulate that hormone distribution and production. We've seen it last. It can last weeks, it can last months, it can last years. And some of you parents who have had children who have had the extended concussion recovery period, we're talking months and years, you've lived through this. You've lived through this, so you really, until you've been there and seen it, it's hard to appreciate how impactful it is upon family. But just to give you an idea, among pediatric patients with mild to moderate TBI, traumatic brain injury, 42% of pediatric patients were found to have significantly lower levels of growth hormones compared to adults with head injuries. And this presentation is going to be available online for you. So hormonal disruption can affect memory, can affect attention, executive function, that's the highest level of functioning the brain's capable of, mood, fatigue, sleep. And we all know the impact of not having good sleep patterns, especially at this age group. And the other thing, and keep in mind, go back in your mind to that picture of the axons, the twisting that you saw. The other thing that's so significant about that, in the adolescent brain, the sheath that covers those axons, specifically the tail that you saw twisted, myelin sheaths is what they're called. They cover the axon to protect the nervous signals in the path, they're not fully formed either. That myelin is not fully formed, and so any type of twisting will tear and shear that myelin much, much easier than it would if you were looking at an adult brain. That's just another same slide again. All right. I'm sorry, John.
Quick question on that. slide, previous slide, the twisting action you talked about, is that because, you know, the brain stem is kind of connected to the to your spine,
yes.
Cord.
Yes.
So it's kind of anchored by that. So when there's
it's anchored by that, and then it the brain floats in that fluid sac within the skull. And so there's a lot of there's a potential for much more movement than you might appreciate,
right.
Especially in the adolescent. Okay. Anatomy lesson over. Thanks for bearing through that. Okay, let's talk about concussion recognition, diagnosis, and acute management. Recognition. We have come so far in being able to recognize a concussion. Signs observed, and I'm not going to read through these to you, I'll let you just glance at those, and then symptoms reported by athlete. And usually the athlete knows when they're not, when something's not right. You can see it in their eyes, they just know. It's not anything that you have to really pull out of them. Recognition, it's been facilitated greatly by having the presence of healthcare providers, more so than we've ever had in the past. Most school systems now are required by law to have some type of health professional on site, either at all games or on staff, athletic trainers, physical therapists, physician's assistants, any healthcare provider that's qualified to be able to recognize and diagnose the symptoms. The tricky part with dealing with adolescent concussions, as many of you know that have been through this, the symptoms may not present right away. They may present immediately, they may take hours to develop. Keep in mind, with an adolescent brain, symptoms can continue to develop for up to 6 weeks as a result of that specific injury. And a lot of times you don't connect those dots. You get an injury on Friday night or a Saturday during a weekend tournament game. 4 weeks down the road, you might notice a mood. You might notice behavior that's out of character for your child, or all of a sudden they're developing almost daily headaches. And if anything else is in play, like weather changes, typically it doesn't click to maybe connect it back to that injury. So sideline evaluations, that's our very first moment when we get a chance to try to determine, are we dealing with a head injury or not? Tendency of athletes, depending on your athletes and how well the information and messages they're receiving from coaches and parents have taken hold. A lot of the kids, I'd say the majority of the kids now that we deal with in our sports program, they're very willing to be honest with us about the symptoms they're having. And that's a credit to you as parents. It's a credit to our school system that puts such an emphasis on concussion education. And at the statewide level, there's legislation now that requires parents and children to view online video tutorials on concussions before they're allowed to participate. So all of that has gone into really helping educate our families and our athletes about this is how it might present, and this is why it's such a big deal with us, and this is why it's important for you to be honest with us if you are having these symptoms following head injury. But having said that, even though that's the case, we're still kind of in a challenging situation. Just as recently as 2004, 41% of possibly concussed athletes reported not wanting to leave the game as a reason for not being honest about the symptoms they were having. 66% of the concussed athletes said they didn't want to report symptoms because they didn't think it was something significant enough to warrant medical attention.
Yes,
this adolescence. We're talking middle school age and high school. And in 2012, a survey of a group of high school football players, a majority of them indicated that they thought it was okay to play through a concussion, despite having the knowledge and the education about what a concussion is and the implications for that. And a lot of that comes from what they're seeing on Saturday and Sunday on TV, when you see interviews with professional athletes that say, yeah, we know all the dangers about concussions, but we're still going to go out and play. That's what we get paid to do. That's what we love to do. And when you're a child, middle school, high school, youth, younger than that, when you see your sports idols saying, yeah, but I'm playing now. There's not anything that's going to keep me out of that game. It's a big game. I want to win. I want to be in. It's hard to undo that. With assessments, our ability to assess concussions have come so far, and we have a whole toolbox now available to us rather than just relying on one particular type of test. And that's what's so great now. If you have to deal with that type of injury, it couldn't be at a better time right now because of all the different assessment tools that we have available to us to really hone in and determine, are we dealing with a head injury? Before, and this happened just, I'll share an example. We had one of our athletes that sustained a concussion just a week ago in a game on Friday night, and it was quite obvious from the symptoms, from the behavior, from the sideline assessment we did, that we were definitely dealing with a concussion. The athlete was sent that evening, didn't even stay for the end of the game, was sent to the ER to be diagnosed or evaluated for a concussion. And the ER physician did one test, had the athlete stand up and said, can you follow my finger? The athlete was able to follow the finger. That's the only test that was administered. The doctor said, you're fine, don't have a concussion. Take it easy this weekend and you can go back to practice on Monday. That was the one test. The other test typically administered in an emergency room is, can you stand on one foot? If they can stand on one foot, your balance is fine, you don't have a concussion. That was old school. Unfortunately, it's still being done, depending on the experience or the training of medical personnel that see those kids first. It's the scary part of it for us that have really gone to that next level of really understanding the injury and understanding how important it is not just to use one type of test to determine what you're dealing with. These are the different tests that we use, that we have access to using on the sideline. And if we have a child that we suspect might have a head injury, we can administer any or all of these immediately as they come off the sideline. And in most states now, in Virginia, the Virginia High School League, and it's been mandated by state legislature also, if we suspect, either the athletic trainer or the official suspect, that a child might have sustained a head injury, we are required by law to pull that child from play, and they're not allowed to return to play until they've been medically evaluated by a physician. So that's the law, that's the state athletic policy, that's our policy, obviously. But we go ahead and start that process. We don't wait to, they may go to the hospital that night, they may go over the weekend. We go ahead and do an immediate assessment right as they come off the field. And then we have that initial, this is how they were immediately after injury, and then we can follow how the symptoms may develop over a period of time. Most of these sideline assessments recommend that you have a baseline profile on your athlete. The only one that doesn't require that is the Glasgow Coma Scale. And that's just it's a very, very old test. They were just starting to use that when I was in my graduate sports medicine program way, way back in the early 80s. Not many people use that to assess a concussion with right now. That's more, may come into play with emergency rescue crews if the child has been rendered unconscious by the hit. We do require our athletes to have baseline assessments conducted prior to participating in any contact drills with their sports season. They're not allowed to start tryouts or do any practice session activity if it involves the potential for contact until they've completed a baseline profile with us.
Coach Gallagher, can you just tell us what, I listened to you say this last year, but the baseline is fully paid for by the schools, or do
yes.
the parents bring the child to a physician? You do that.
We do the testing here, and the protocol that we use right now is called concussion vital signs. You're probably familiar with impact tests. That's what we used to use for that was the first test format that we put in when I first came to George Mason, and 2 years ago we transitioned to this new concussion vital signs. It's a much more thorough test. We have an annual subscription to that online protocol that we use, and the wonderful thing about the concussion vital signs protocol is that it has a clinician portal. So your child has a unique athlete ID, and if you go to if you find yourself in the position of having to go to a physician or an emergency room for further medical evaluation, you simply need to provide that athlete ID to the physician. They can pull that account up online as you're there and view everything on file that we have on file, the baseline assessments. If we've done a post-injury assessment, they can access that right there in the emergency room or in the doctor's office while you're there. And based on what they see, they have the ability to administer a test through our account there. At that point, if it's the doctor administering the test through our account, it's a $15, usually $15 charge.
And can you just say which athlete, what type of sports would receive the baseline?
We do we do all sports that have the potential for contact or head injury. I can tell you, it's easier to tell you the sports we don't test. We don't test for golf. We don't test cross country or track. We make that available if any of the parents of those athletes want their child baselined. We would never turn a family down if they're involved in a sport where we don't test or establish baseline profiles. One, we didn't used to test tennis. How many of you play tennis at all? We didn't used to do baseline assessments on tennis, on our tennis teams, but then one afternoon, this happened 2 years ago, I'll never forget it, I had taken a rare afternoon off, and I had just gotten home, my cell phone rings, and it's our tennis coach, and he says, one of my guys has a concussion. I said, how did that happen? Yeah, no, the kid, he was going to execute a forehand stroke, and he swung so hard that the racket wrapped around his head and hit him in the back of the head, and he did. In all honesty, he gave himself a concussion. So after that, we started doing baseline profiles on our tennis teams. So anyway, the thing that we've also learned now, though, it's not just about once you've established that you are dealing with a concussion or head injury. It's not just about the physical rest, it's also about the cognitive rest. And I've talked with you about that in the past, and we're becoming more educated in terms of what cognitive rest is, why it's important, but it's also the greatest challenge. Greatest challenge.
When the MRI showed.
Yes. Well, there are two different types of MRIs that can be utilized to assess for concussion. I'm going to come up to those in just a moment, if I can hold off on that for just a second. The cognitive rest piece, that is by far the most challenging piece for healthcare providers, for us within the school system, because of such pressure that children and families feel, whether real or perceived, the fear of the child falling behind in school. And we have two active cases right now here at the high school where it's just a constant battle daily to pull these families off the cliff because of the fear and the stress of they can't not do homework. They can't not be in school because they're going to get behind. And so our response is, okay, will you at least acknowledge that we have a head injury? Yes, we know he has a concussion, but they can't not get behind. Okay, so we're on the same page here. We have a head injury. we realize that when you have a head injury, the brain's not functioning as it should or can. We agree on that. What's going to happen when you put a kid into a school setting for 8 hours? It goes downhill very, very quickly, and more often than not, by about 2 hours into the school day, the kids are down in the health clinic having to call parents to come pick them up because of the severe headaches they've developed. So, I understand the frustration, the stress. I think we all do, especially those of you who have children that are starting the college application process. But honestly, the toughest conversation you have to have with a family is discussing the possibility of it might be in your child's best interest to drop or withdraw from this class or take a semester off or repeat a grade. That's a tough conversation to have. It's not a conversation that any family wants to have. You don't want to think of the possibility of a child losing a year or a month or a semester or a quarter in school. But by pushing that envelope, by insisting that they try to stay up, you know, you might not get your A's, but if you get B's or C's, we're okay with that. Just, you got to be in school. You're simply guaranteeing the lengthening of that recovery process, and you're borderline almost setting that child up for having possible interruptions in brain growth and repair that might not be able to be reversed. And so sometimes you have to have that tough conversation. How worth it is it for your child to be struggling in school so that they don't get behind versus 20 years from now, they might not have that brain functioning capability that they would have had otherwise. And that's a tough conversation to have, but if you can just put yourself 5, 10, 15 years down the road, how tough would it be to have a conversation about not remembering your birthday or not remembering that you got married or not remembering this or that or not being able to do basic math? So as we move from immediate assessment, there's a whole process that's involved with follow-up assessment in determining the extent of the head injury. Most physicians are hesitant to prescribe a lot of these diagnostic imaging options, MRIs, CT scans, in the absence of relevant physical symptoms. If you send a child to the hospital the day or night of the injury and their symptoms haven't presented fully at that point, it's very unlikely that they're going to be sent for an MRI or CAT scan because of the concern for exposure to radiation. And Gabby, help me keep track of times. Okay.
The experience that I've had is that when you go to the ER, they're more worried about blood clot.
A hematoma.
That's their concern.
Right.
If you go in several days later, they said to me, well, if you had a blood clot, you're dead by now. So you need to go to your regular doctor, so that way we're not going to authorize
right. an MRI. That's their immediate concern because that can be almost instantly.
Well, I agree.
Right.
But I think in terms of their protocol, in terms of, whether they can offer.
Right. The concern there is, it's almost like when we have an athlete that sprains an ankle and you send them to be checked and they come back and say, well, the x-rays were negative. Well, then you have to tell the child and the family, well, standard x-rays don't show ligament structures. So we don't know any more now than we did before you went and got the x-ray. The thing you have to understand about the different types of diagnostic imaging is that a CT scan shows one thing that an MRI does not. An MRI shows something that a CT doesn't.
But so I guess maybe I'm saying that the route may not be the ER.
Right, exactly.
They turn you away and say you're fine.
Right. And if we feel fairly confident as healthcare providers at our on the front line, so to speak, that that's what we're dealing with, we encourage families to seek a specialist rather than losing time at in an ER or even sometimes with primary care physicians.
Yeah.
Some primary care physicians are wonderfully trained in knowing what to look for and how to assess concussions. Others are not. So let me go through these different types of assessments that are available and how they're used, and I think that will help give you knowledge if you ever find yourself in this situation, what testing is important for you to discuss with your healthcare provider, okay? Because sometimes if you don't ask about these, they're not offered. The neuropsychological testing, that refers to the type of testing that we do here. It's the impact test, the concussion vital signs test. It assesses cognitive function, memory, speed, processing time, reaction time, how quickly your brain can get information out to the body and cause actions to occur. And it is sensitive to pre and post-injury state. It is sensitive to learning disabilities. A lot of families will ask, well, my child is ADHD or they have this condition or this learning disability, how accurate is their baseline profile going to be compared to a post-injury assessment? The baseline profiles of these neurocognitive assessments, neuropsychological assessments, are sensitive to those types of situations, those types of conditions. Impact was the gold standard for years and years and years. It's what we used here. It was developed by two of the directors of the Sports Concussion Division at University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, Dr. Mickey Collins and Mark Lovell. Concussion Vital Signs took that test to the next level. It tests the brain on a deeper level. Different areas of the brain are assessed by Concussion Vital Signs than the impact does. So we feel very, very fortunate to have had the opportunity to transition to that test protocol. CT scan, and I'm going to go through these real quickly. I don't want to bog you down in the nuances of these tests, but just to give you a quick picture of what they do or don't do. CT scan, what they're using that scan for is to look for skull fracture, bleeding, the epidural, the subdural hematoma, or brain swelling. And you can see the American Academy of Neurology advises against CT in the absence of relevant physical symptoms. I will tell you that I've been involved or associated with cases where the high school athlete was seen in the emergency room, was not presenting with relevant symptoms, was not given a CT scan because no symptoms were present, and was released, and within a half hour of getting home, symptoms presented, and back to the ER in an emergency situation. There was bleeding going on in the brain, there was swelling, it just wasn't caught because the test wasn't administered because the symptoms weren't there. Diffusion tensor imaging, this is probably going to quickly rise to the top in terms of the test that will give you the most accurate idea of whether you do have a concussion present. It uses, it tracks the movement of water molecules in the white matter of the brain. Those pathways, the subway system of your brain, water molecules move through those pathways, and so that's what this diagnostic test tracks.
Is there any radiation
in that? No, and that's the other advantage of this test. So here on the left, you'll see a concussed brain, and on the right you see a normal. So see where you have black spaces and less than blue? That, the less blue you have, the more damage has occurred to those white matter tracks, those pathways in the brain. Top row are two images, DTI images of a concussed brain. The one on the left is a normal. See these broad pathways of the green? You see how they're thinner on the right? That's where the damage has already started to occur in the brain tissue. On the bottom, that's an MRI image. Right image is has sustained the injury?
It's MRIs are, you know, probably, you know, one of the greatest resources, but it takes very experienced radiologists to read.
It takes an experienced radiologist to read it. It's not a quick test. Usually you're talking about 45 minutes to 60 minutes. Yes, exactly.
But there's no radiation in
MRI. No. No, it uses magnetic resonance. And here's another DTI image. And again, you'll see on the right where you see less of the blue. You've got less, that means you're not getting transmission of water molecules where you don't see the blue. So those tracks of the white matter have been damaged. They're not transferring information or nutrients or anything in that area. And just one more. Again, you see the lack of the blue there and where the arrow is. MRI uses magnetic field impulses or radio waves to disturb water molecules in the brain. And it can identify brain lesions and bleeding. Now there's an MRI, and then there's a functional MRI. The functional MRI gives you more information, and the difference there is, during a functional MRI, the patient, the athlete, is being engaged mentally while the MRI is occurring. So you will see activity in the brain real time, and it isolates which areas of the brain have been impacted by that injury. PET scan, we see these quite often as the imaging choice that we get reports back on. It measures cerebral blood flow and also glucose metabolism. EEG, that detects changes in the brain's electrical processing ability. And then serum biomarkers. This is where all the interest is right now. There are two major universities now conducting studies in this area, Temple University and George Mason University. They've identified a genetic biomarker that they think is present, what they're initially seeing in the research is present in concussed brains, and it's not present in non-concussed brains. So this has the potential to be really, really beneficial in terms of assessing the presence of a concussion or the extent of it. George Mason University, the biomarker that they're studying is saliva. They've found a protein marker that appears in the saliva that they're not seeing in normal or control subjects. And that study is ongoing. It's in its third year right now. Signs and symptoms. Again, this goes toward helping you be more aware of how to assess or what to look for. Symptoms usually fall in four categories: somatic or physical, cognitive, thinking, processing ability, affective, those emotional behaviors that you see change, and sleep patterns. And I'm just going to go through these. I'm just going to flip through these and just let you glance without spending too much time on that. The emotional symptoms tend to cause the most stress for the kids that I've dealt with in this age, because they don't like to not have control of their behavior, their emotions, and that tends to be incredibly stressful for them. Sleep symptoms. Sleeping more than usual, sleeping less, trouble falling asleep, trouble staying asleep once you get to sleep, and then in some of the extended recovery periods where we're beyond months, you see insomnia quite often. Had one high school athlete that went a period of almost 14 days without sleep, without being able to go to sleep. Yeah.
Which has other physiological effects, because the whole process of exchanging oxygen oxygen for carbon dioxide and stuff.
It is, absolutely. Managing prolonged symptoms in the post-concussion syndrome. The post-concussion syndrome simply refers, it's what clinicians use to refer to a concussion recovery that extends beyond that normal 2-week period. In about 10 to 20% of the cases, and this is up from about 5 to 10%. If you remember when we were with each other a couple years ago, then the percentage was about 5% experienced extended recovery. We're now seeing that number rise a little bit, 10 to 20% of the concussive injuries. And what we think explains that number, kids are bigger, stronger. The intensity and level of play is higher, and there's more competition. And that's just what we've talked about.
That's also that sometimes adults, I mean, much later, you know, in the 50s and 60s or something,
mm-hmm.
they have a whole lot of symptoms.
This is what they're looking at in conjunction with chronic CTE, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, the studies that are going on with the NFL players right now. This is kind of the precursor to that. They're seeing post-concussion syndrome in some athletes that they followed 10 to 20 years after their last involvement with athletic activity. To manage this prolonged recovery, this syndrome, it takes a multifaceted approach, and we've been very fortunate here in Falls Church within our school system. We have that approach in place, and it has made all the difference in how these kids recover and the quality of life once they get to the other side of that recovery. We used to, even the doctors used to refrain from putting physical activity in the mix at all until they were convinced that recovery was complete. Now they've kind of changing their thought on that. They're seeing now that low-level intensity activity is encouraging the recovery process. And by low-level intensity, we're talking about walking, light jogging even, bike riding, swimming, low-level strength training even has been prescribed for some of our long-term recovery kids.
How much access do you have professionals like yourself had to the military's efforts to deal with DPI soldiers, military services actually? There's been so many incidents of DPI that my impression is they're doing a lot in
Well, that's a great question, because I'm excited to tell you that we have partnered with a medical engineering firm in Maryland called Anthrotronics, and they have the contract with the Department of Defense. They designed the testing protocol and device that all military personnel are tested on. They do all the baseline, the test protocol that they developed and the device that they developed is what every member of the military, all branches of the military use. They have to do baseline assessments, and then it's also how they're tested in the field for post-injury. The Department of Defense and Anthrotronics, in doing that work together, they were getting such good results out of the testing mechanism and what it was allowing them to put in place quicker, that they decided that that technology needed to be brought down to youth athletics. And so we've partnered with them. We were the only school system in the entire country that they partnered with to do this research. We've completed one pilot study with them. We're just finishing up a second pilot study, and what the things that we've been doing with them in partnership, and this is going to be passed up to the military, and it's going to be passed out to college levels and down to the high school and middle school levels, the results that that they get from the data that we've collected in the testing. And what we've, the study that we're just completing right now looks at the timing of testing. We're bringing a group of 30 athletes in right now once a week for a period of time at 8 o'clock in the morning before they've done anything. They roll out of bed literally and then come see me. We do a test, and then we bring them back at 3 o'clock after a full day of school. And we're doing this on a control group, and we also have athletes that are in the midst of a concussion as this study has been going on. And what we're tracking, what we're trying to see is how much drop-off do you have in brain functioning with a normal, non-injured brain during the course of a day as a result of cognitive work effort, 8 hours of school, cognitive fatigue, physical fatigue, just in a normal setting. What kind of drop-off are you seeing? And then how does that affect how the numbers look on kids that you're getting with that have head injuries or military personnel? Does it matter what time of day you test them? Does that skew the result that you're getting, which could impact the type of care that you're administering or recommending? So we're real excited to be involved in this research. And believe it or not, what the work we've done with them, it even shows that the device that you test a head injury patient on can make a difference in the results that you see. We're testing the kids on a tablet device. We've typically always tested them for the neuropsychological testing on computers. Then we shifted a little to laptops, but we're finding now that the tablet device, we're getting truer assessment of the extent of the injury. So, all right, I'm getting ready to be pulled off stage, so I'm going to go quickly. So the impact of this injury in this age group, it not only impacts the child, but it also puts a tremendous stress and burden on the family because of the amount of care that's required to manage this injury. It takes you away from your normal interactions with your spouse or your other children, siblings. It's just a completely encompassing injury to deal with. In the last few minutes I'm going to take, because I know it's been a long day and I appreciate your attention at the end of a long day, I may go through a couple of these and let you have a chance to look at them on your own, and if you want to call me up or email or whatever, I'll talk all day long to you. I want to get a couple of things just real quick before we run out of time. And if you'll bear with me, I'm going to jump. I know you've all heard all the information about what they're looking at with pro football players, the chronic traumatic encephalopathy, the brain disease, Alzheimer's. And unfortunately, a lot of this research can't be done until they've passed away and made their brains available for study. But what we're learning a tremendous amount of information about that. And I just wanted to show you. I thought you would find this interesting. Top and bottom row, that first row on the left, normal brain. In the middle, that is the brain tissue, the brain imaging of a football player within the first 6 months of head trauma. They're still active. The row, the column on the right, is the same brain where the injury has progressed. The damage to the brain tissue is just progressive. So all that blue area that you don't see, that's areas of the brain where information transmission is not happening.
Do they still play from NFL 1 to NFL 3?
Yes.
They're still playing. So it's not, the damage was terrible and done and then you stop.
These NFL 3s, these are, you typically are seeing this type of damage in players that have had multiple concussions. And if you, just this last week, you heard interviews with players that said, one player interviewed said, I've had 30 concussions that I know of. the evidence, and this number here, 76 of 79 former players that have had degenerative brain disease, that was, those numbers are from players that have passed away. So the reason, why are we talking about, why does it make any difference what's happening with the pro players, with our youth athletes? What we're learning is it's not so much the major ESPN highlight hits that are, they're causing the concern and the long-term damage. It's the little bumps and bruises that you get day in and day out, practices, games. Those of you that have or are involved with youth football programming, they've just completed, in February 2012, they took seven youth football players ages 7 to 8 years old, typical helmets, and unfortunately, the helmets that our youth football players wear are just scaled-down versions of the pro helmets, the college helmets, and they're not appropriate, they're not designed for the adolescent skull or brain. So we're wearing a piece of protection that doesn't really protect the way we think that it might be. Those helmets were equipped with accelerometers that gauged the degree of motion of the brain inside the skull as the hits occurred. I think these numbers are just eye-opening. They registered 748 impacts, with each player sustaining about 107 head impacts during the course of a season.
I mean, you're talking about this was just during their season.
And you know, a 7 and 8 year old season. Right, no, that's a relatively short season. So if you can imagine your child, 7 or 8 years old, sustaining 107 head impacts, where that brain is moving, axons are twisting, blood vessels are stretching, nerve pathways, nerves are stretching. That's the concern. Do I love football? Yes. Am I saying that you shouldn't play football? No. But what type of football are we having our kids engage in at that level? Do they need to be engaged in contact football versus flag football versus, that's what we're talking about. And the linear accelerations, that the speed and velocity of the brain jarring inside the skull, registered from 10 to 100 G. That's tremendous. And they found that the majority of the high-level impacts were occurring in practice. So what legislatures and youth leagues are looking at now, should contact drills, high-impact drills, be eliminated in practice sessions? And I can tell you that the Virginia High School League, they're involved right now in an ongoing study as to whether they're going to make recommendations or put into effect hit counts for football. We have a count in place for baseball pitchers. They're now looking at that same type of number for football. Youth ice hockey, people think that we're just talking about football. Football is quickly being overtaken by youth ice hockey and soccer. The numbers are, I would say, probably within this year or the coming year, within 6 months, you're going to see youth ice hockey and soccer head injuries surpass what you're seeing, the numbers you're seeing in football. Body checking is the culprit in ice hockey. And I'm sorry?
What is that, body checking?
Body checking is where they actually come up and bump into you, yeah, with a stick or whatever. USA Hockey has just recently raised the age for body checking from age 11 to 12 to age 13, 14, to try to minimize that damage, give the brain a little bit more time to mature. And the other anatomy piece that you're dealing with, adolescents, until their body catches up with the size of their skull and brain, you've got a big head on a small body, and when it gets impacted, it's just like those bobblehead dolls. Their neck isn't strong enough to protect or minimize that motion. You see that with youth soccer, they're looking at age 14 in terms of when they don't think you should be engaged in the heading or the contact. And it's not only the heading. You know, they talk about, well, if you gotta, you've got to teach them how to correctly head the ball. But you know, and I know, if you've ever watched a practice, you can teach great technique, but the second they go do a drill or get in a game situation, great technique goes out the window. And with soccer, what they're seeing, where they're seeing the concern is, a lot of the heading, it's not the straight ahead, straightforward heading that's causing the problem. It's the flick. How many of you seen the flick? You know what I'm talking about in soccer. That's where they're seeing a lot of damage starting to occur in youth soccer players, the flicking, because you get the rotational shifting in the brain with that flicking. And they actually have determined a count, a head count, that they think is where you kind of see the step off of that brain damage long-term coming up, and it's 1,500 head contacts from heading and practice during the course of a...
I think
you
also
do
a lot of head to head.
Yes. Exactly. That and the other thing that we're seeing a lot is when they both go up to head the ball and they come down and they land on their back or their butt without, when they don't come down on their feet, and they have that, especially when they're playing on turf. They're really concerned with youth soccer about the damage they're seeing to the axons and the white matter in the brain, what they've studied thus far, what they're seeing on the imaging, because those axons do not regenerate. Once they've twisted to the point of dying or not being able to repair themselves, they don't regenerate back. And so you've lost that ability to translate, to move information within the brain. They can, depending on the severity of the twist. Youth sports concerns across the board, increased pressure by adults, increased intensity of play, the size and strength of players. We've got, and it's crazy, you have 8 to 10 year olds, 7 to 10 year olds that have personal sports trainers. Now, I've seen them work out down on our field while football practice is going on. There is such competition and pressure to generate that next great star. And the younger they start, the more exposure they have.
Some of it is also that it's getting lower and lower and lower when you have to make a choice. I mean, if you don't keep up, then you're out. Mm-hmm. So it's getting lower and lower and lower. So even if you could be great, you've waited too long to do it, and everybody else, meanwhile, is already doing their travel teams. And that's what you're shocked by.
I know. And our response back to that, and it's not a soccer-specific example, but it's the one we like to use, is Tom Brady, quarterback for New England Patriots, his parents did not allow him to play contact football until he was 15 years of age. So, the other thing that we're really trying to tighten up is inconsistent enforcement of rules. A little bit on helmets there. There are no helmets on the market, not soccer helmets, not lacrosse helmets, not football helmets. No helmet on the market that will prevent a concussion. None. Helmets can prevent skull fractures. They will not prevent a concussion. So, why do you see all those soccer helmets? Why do you see? Should we not even bother wearing the helmets? You should, but just don't be lulled into the sense of security that they're preventing a concussion. Okay, let me see where we are. Most of this just refers to the things that we're doing, the educational programs, the rule enforcement. State legislatures have gotten involved now, and we, you know, abiding by that graduated return to play, return to learn. We know now that it's just as important to gradually reintroduce cognitive activity as it is physical activity. Thanks for hanging in there with me. That was a lot.
Thank you.